comedic ability. In school, were you funny? Were you the class clown?
Well, I guess funny you should ask that question, because one of the nuns in high school, I was a very shy little girl, very, very shy.
I don't believe that.
It is true, David. I wouldn't fib to you. And one of the nuns at Immaculate Heart High School, where I went to school, one day I was late for class, and I crawled in on my knees, and she caught me. And she said, "Patricia Carroll, you'd do anything to get attention." I thought, well, I guess I should be an actor then.
And here you are.
And here I is.
Well, how did you really get your start in show business? What was your first big break?
I don't know if I've ever had a big break, David. I'm still waiting patiently for that big break. I can't think of anything that was a big break. I've just been fortunate enough to keep working professionally since 1947. Isn't that wonderful?
That's fantastic.
Every day I say thank you, Lord, because this profession, bless it, is probably the most insecure business in the world. And anyone who enters it will quickly learn either to get out or to stay in it because they love it. And I have a younger daughter, Tara Carcian, who has been in the business now for 20 years. And she says, "Mother, if I could do anything else, I would, but this is the only thing I really love." I said, "Then don't leave it. You keep doing what you love, no matter what the insecurities are. That doesn't make any difference. Everything is insecure. So you might as well do what you love." Am I right?
You are right.
In 2 weeks to $25,491 thus far, and you're not finished yet, okay?
Oh, I don't know.
You look great. Mr. Murray, good luck with your poodles and your golden retriever. I hope they'll get along well. Mr. Panetti, you too. And Pat, thank you very much for coming by.
Well, I didn't do too well, Bill, but I thoroughly enjoyed being here.
I seem to remember you did pretty well the last time you were here, though.
I think I only pooped out once before.
The law of averages are catching up with you.
Much resistance to the idea of females entering into the comedy field?
Oh, females have always been in the comedy field, David. It's just that a lot of people were prejudiced against them. I think it always went against the female image for a woman to be funny. But within families everywhere, they talk about Aunt Tilly, who is a hoot, and Grandma Marion, who will just keep you in stitches. Women have a sense of humor, always have had, in many cases within families. They've been the only ones to keep the beacon of laughter alive. And I just think that the translation to the theatrical profession was not difficult for women, except for the prejudice of people who did not want to see them acting silly. They wanted them to maintain themselves as ladies. Well, please forgive me, but ladies have a sense of humor as well. I think it was mostly gentlemen who did not wish to see ladies out there making, as my grandmother said, making a fool of yourself. I always loved that. But I do think that we have come a long way, and I think Lucy Ball set the standard for ladies in comedy because she was quite lovely to look at. She could be a glamour puss 1 second and the next second minute be trying to make those cookies go faster in the factory. She was the epitome of a woman who could do or be anything. She was also really, I think, a quite good serious actress, but she, after the success of Lucy, she did not want to disappoint her fans, so she continued doing her comedy. And, you know, she learned to do comedy at MGM under the aegis of Rags Ragland, an old burlesque comic. And that dear man, you know, who was as big and as good as Chaplin with the sad puss. What is his name? That escapes me. My years show up
Buster
right.
Buster Keaton?
Buster Keaton, you win.
Okay.
You win the big prize this evening. Buster Keaton and dear Rags Ragland were under contract to MGM, but their job was not so much to act in front of the cameras, though they did do that, but they started a comedy school at MGM to teach young, burgeoning actors and actresses for the films to do comedy. Lucy used to talk about how they would make them take home props and work with the physical prop until it was second nature. And if you think of Lucille Ball on her program dealing with stilts, or dealing with anything that was physical, an object, you knew she was in charge of it. It wasn't in charge of her. She was, I think, brilliant at prop work and comedy. She was just wonderful. But I think Lucy really changed it for young women coming into the theatrical profession because she broke the mold. And I think she made everybody realize that women could do comedy without changing their feminine characteristics at all. Now, she could mug and act up a storm and black out her teeth and do anything she wanted, but you always knew it was pretty Lucy under there. And I think she really helped every young girl who wanted to do comedy more than play heavy, serious, dramatic roles. And I bless her for that.
They're ready. Panel, I think you can already hear me. Yes, they're blindfolded. Our guest, Charles Nelson Reilly, is here on stage, as you probably assume. And his secret concerns something that he's doing, and we'll start the questioning with Pat Carroll. Go right ahead, Charles, and do it.
Charles, what you're doing right now, is it something serious?
Well, of course it's serious.
Are you dancing?
What is it, dear?
Are you dancing?
I'm very involved in my work. Am I dancing?
Yes.
No, but I could later on. No.
I accept. Are you doing yoga exercises?
No, but if that's your bag, good luck to you.
All right, Pat, you alone may take off your blindfold and watch what's happening here. Gene Rayburn?
Charles.
Who was your greatest benefactor along your life?
My greatest benefactor?
Yeah. Who helped you the most?
Everyone I ever met. Everyone I ever met has helped me in one way or another. They have been so kind. And that's what I'm fighting about these days. This is a quality we've lost in our lives. Kindness. It's not difficult. Kindness is very easy if you set your mind to it. And my mother said something to me once when I was quite young. She said, Patsy, I was known as Patsy Ann when I was young. She said, Patsy, if you do one thing for another human being every day of your life, you'll be a very happy person. And I think my mother was right. And I don't care how small it is. And my mother was an example. There wasn't a person who was down of spirit or not well that they didn't get a card or a phone call or a visit. She made practical the act of kindness. And people knew she was sincere. And they knew that she meant it, and she wanted to do this. It was not a pro forma thing for her in her life. She really felt kindness as a daily act we should all engage in. I bless my mother for many things, but that one little quote just has stayed with me all of my life, and I try to follow it as best I can.
I don't think
I'm as good as my mother.
I think you just answered the question of who were your best benefactor. I think it was your mother.
I think you're right.
I think it was.
I think you're right.
Now, Pat, your talent put you in great demand for early television. You did the Danny Thomas show?
Yes.
You did the Dick Van Dyke show?
No, I didn't.
I thought you... I saw you on one. Didn't I see
no,
you on
that was
episode?
On the Mary Tyler Moore
Mary
show.
Tyler, where, I
do you know I got hate mail because of
why?
That? Because I was so mean to Mary Tyler Moore? I tell you, I got hate mail. How dare you treat our Mary that?
Goodness.
And I wanted to say, I get paid for that. I love Mary. She's
<You're an>
fabulous.
Hi.
Oh, swell. They didn't tell me I'd be rooming with a go-go dancer. Am I in time for the supper show, or have you gone on already?
You mean this nightgown thing? Mm-hmm. Well, it's not really mine.
Yeah. Well, this isn't mine either. I borrowed it from Princess Grace.
Listen, I was just wondering which bed you'd like. Either one is fine with me.
You know, if there is anything I love, it is long debates concerning bed assignments.
What was your favorite role?
Probably the one I did in the theater and toured for 5 years. It was a one-woman show based on the life of Gertrude Stein,
okay.
The expatriate
yes.
writer.
Yeah.
And in that show, I stood on a stage for 2 hours and never stopped talking.
And I'm surprised you could do that.
Yes, I am too. Isn't it amazing? How did that woman do that? She's so retiring. But it probably said everything I had to say about what acting is about. And it also had taught me a great deal about Gertrude Stein, whom I thought could not write. When I was in college, I said, oh, I can write better than she can. Oh, can you, dear, really? Oh, how interesting. But I learned so much doing research on the woman, and I ultimately gained a great deal of respect for her, her capabilities, what she did, how she impacted people. Oh, I hate that word. Why did I use it? Nah, I just spat it out. I hate that word, impacted. It sounds like some kind of car. Oh, I'm driving a blue impacted these days.
Or a tooth removal.
Or a tooth removal, indeed. But I think I probably learned more about myself as a performer and about audience. My second favorite was Ursula in The Little Mermaid.
I was going to ask, did you ever play a villain?
No, not to my knowledge.
Was
people
Ursula
may have thought
villain?
I was villainous, but no. And I had a ball.
Yeah.
Because I conceived Ursula to be a used car salesperson who had formerly been a Shakespearean actress. That image so hit me when I got it.
Yeah.
And, of course, the way the animators drew the figure, you got so much from the drawings of that character. But she was such fun to do. To be mean is fun.
Yeah.
It is just delicious to be villainous. I loved every second of filming that, and I've delighted in it ever since then.
Very good. Since you worked with many stars, who
was wasn't I lucky?
You were. Who would you say was the most fun to do a scene with? Do you have any recollections of really just breaking down because it was so funny?
Yes, and there are many stars that I worked with that tickled and delighted me. Danny Thomas was a little minx, but my favorite was Jimmy Durante, because I had adored him since I was about knee-high to a grasshopper. And I got to work with him. I had done a special in New York with Max Liebman, and Jimmy was the guest star. I was so excited, my heart was palpitating. I get to meet Jimmy Durante. I get to work with Jimmy Durante.
Good night, good night. It's time to say good night. Good night. What more is there to say but good night? Folks, I'll be back next week. And good night, folks. And good night, Mrs. Calabash, wherever you are.
He was an angel. He was exactly what you see was what you got. The man was extraordinary as a human being. I would go to lunch with Jimmy, and people were walking off the street because they heard Jimmy Durante was in there. Presidents of corporations, senators, presidents of banks, a guy who was digging a ditch. He covered everybody because they knew this was a piece of honest goods. Jimmy Durante wouldn't lie to you. Jimmy Durante wouldn't be mean to you. He might pronounce some words incorrectly. But that was the worst thing he would commit. The man was a gentle man, if there ever was one.
You're giving us a lot of insight.
And he made me laugh constantly, because when he would mispronounce something, Jimmy really did not realize that he had done that. I mean, he wasn't doing it as part of an act. He was doing it because that's the way he was. And he wouldn't realize that he had said that. And he just... Well, number one, I was so in love with that dear man and the way he worked that to work with him, which I only did once, that one time, was a treasure for me. I've never forgotten it. I came home with a big smile on my face every day. That man tickled and delighted.
One more last question. Why did you pick Cape Cod to retire to?
Oh, for a very good reason. There was a huge earthquake in California.
It tossed you right out of the state?
Talk about being a wash ashore. That's a long wave that took me here.
It took a long wave to get you here.
But it was 1994, and the very horrendous Northridge earthquake occurred, and I was staying with my two daughters. It scared the living daylights out of me, David. It scared me to pieces. I woke up at 4:30 in the morning and found God again. I tell you, I was one frightened creature. And I don't know that I could live in Los Angeles again, because my fear was so great, and I just knew I couldn't stay in
and
L.A.
Cape Cod doesn't rumble too much.
Thank God.
Thank God.
It snows, and there's some rain occasionally, but aren't we lucky on Cape Cod this year? I'm telling you that. But that's the reason I came to Cape Cod, and I couldn't be happier I made that decision.
Thank you, Pat Carroll. We've enjoyed spending some time with
you. Thank you, David. I've enjoyed talking to you. Bye, Pixie.